Om Sahanavavatu, Sahanao Bhunaktu, Sahaviryankaravavahai, Tejasvinavaditamastu, Mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. May the Divine Being look over us lovingly as a mother and father. May the Divine Being support and nourish us as a mother and father. May we have the strength and skill to study together the art of spirituality. May no misunderstandings arise amongst us. Om peace, peace, peace be unto us and to all beloved beings everywhere. So good afternoon, everyone, and namaste. Welcome to our class on Swami Prabhavananda's How to Know God, his translation of and commentary on Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. We're in chapter one, Sutra 17, and the Swami remarks. Well, first, is there anything left over from last week that anyone would like to mention, or any concern or question they'd like to raise based on what on the manana you've been doing about what we studied last week? Anything at all from anyone? All right. So, we've been talking about the gunas, tamas, rajas, sattva, tamas, the concealing power, rajas, the projecting power, and sattva, the revealing power. Some of the images used were tamas, a block of granite, the pivot for a fulcrum, stable, full of inertia, the rajas, the projecting power. The image used was that of an erupting volcano, rage and anger and passion. Lust are all associated with rajas. And then sattva. The image used was of sunlight and the description was of contentment. All three are known as the three robbers. Because each has the capacity to keep us enmeshed in some way in Maya. So these are the gunas that we've been talking about. And the Swami remarks, several chapters of the Bhagavad Gita are devoted to the gunas and their manifestations. The spiritual aspirant is advised to transcend them by a discipline or discrimination. Transcend them. What does it mean, transcend them? There's three states of being within time, space, and causation. Are your waking awareness, sleep, and dreamless sleep. Dream sleep and dreamless sleep. Waking awareness, dream sleep, and dreamless sleep. or the conscious awareness, the subconscious awareness, and the unconscious awareness. There is consciousness or awareness in all three states. To transcend them means to ascend through, as the Swami says, discipline or discrimination, to Turiya, the fourth state of being, which is beyond time, space, and causation. And this is what's meant by transcend the gunas. It's said of Sri Ramakrishna that he is above the gunas three. This is said in the evening hymn. The glory of this is that he extends the invitation to share that transcendence with us. He has come to set us free. And what must we do? What must we do? Set aside fame, fortune, friends, the dependence on these things, and in one way or another, through devotion or whatever path we follow, gain pure love for Sri Ramakrishna or the divine presence in whatever form it draws our attention. So having said all that, before we go on, is there any comment from your own wisdom or experience, or any concern or question that any of this raises, this business of transcending the three gunas? All right.
I have a comment or
yes, please.
Comment or question until I say it. About transcending and about the part that you just read of the breaker of this world's chain, mm-hmm. setting aside friends and family and fame is a whole nother thing, but a lot of us will kind of we'll go, whoa, what? set aside my friends and my family. But it really doesn't mean that, of course, because it's setting aside the attachment to those things.
Dependence on and attachment to, yes.
Right, like I can't live without so-and-so, and telling yourself that story to the point that when that person leaves the planet, your life implodes. But it's not to say setting aside love.
Oh no.
And in fact, I find the more I have practiced this, not being attached in that old way to people, like dependence on them for my very existence, the more I'm able to love. And it's not that I don't grieve when I lose somebody, I certainly do. But there's something there, and it is the divine.
Yes.
It has taken the place of my dependence on yes. things that are transient.
Yes.
No matter how lovely they are and wonderful. It's not doesn't say they aren't lovely and wonderful for the embodied being. It just says, you know, we're all going to die.
And therefore, Swami Prabhavananda said, the only one who is truly your own is the Lord. Mm-hmm. And in whatever manifestation of that divine presence appeals to your heart. So yes to everything you've said. Anything from anyone else? Thank you, Cindy.
I just want to go a little bit further with what Cindy said, and that was beautiful, Cindy. Thank you. for sharing that. What I'm coming to find is that we, in general, I myself included, we confuse neediness and dependency with love. And I think the more we release the neediness and the dependency, the more room that is left for true love to come in. And I think the mind, the ego, interprets, I can't live without you, as a declaration of love. The ego thinks it's a compliment. So the more that, and it's taken me a while to accept that, but I'm starting to see more and more that the more I move from that neediness, that dependency, that whole thing that Cindy had just mentioned, that I'm not moving further away from love, that I'm actually moving into a purer love. That's what I'm finding.
So beautifully said, Frank. Exactly. That's exactly it. Neediness and love are not the same thing. And yes, neediness is there. But we have to look at it for what it is and say, well, that's just my deficit. That's my, and as you say, the more we can see it for what it is, the more room there is for true and pure love to arise, because then we're loving that which is rather than that which is transient, that will come and go. Anything else from anyone? This is wonderful.
Brother Shagra, so wonderfully described by Cindy and Frank. I think you covered everything. Thank you so much. That was just a wonderful description.
Indeed. Okay.
If I could just add one thing, Amadas here.
Yes,
Amadas. One thing that came up for me as Cindy was sharing is that if my commitment is to service to my family, then the higher my state of consciousness, the more that I follow the breaker of chains, the more leveraged my service is. So I'm not actually leaving them behind. I'm leaving my attachment to whatever service I'm offering now to reach a higher level of leveraged action in a greater way, just a place from which the service can be more efficient. I don't know if I'm making any sense.
Oh, absolutely. The clearer our vision, the more we see what's truly needed in the way of service. So we don't impose on people what we think they need. We are truly sustaining and comforting them with what they truly need, which is, this is revealed to us when we set aside, as you said, the lesser forms, and focus on the divine presence.
Thanks. Yes.
And that made perfect sense. Anything else?
Yes, Brother Shankara.
Yes, Nira.
Yes, resonate with the service aspect and also transcending, you know, to a higher spiritual practice and going above gunas. But what about duty as a role that we have to play? Duty to our family, duty to the community, to the society. Because Bhagavad Gita says we should do our daily duties, you know, and then it goes on to say various other duties and to society.
Well, it's perfectly clear, Nira, contained in what you said. The duties are there, but there's no attachment to them. We simply do them because they are our duties, as Amadas said, his duties to his family, his mother and his father, And through just doing that, without attachment, without expectation of reward or results, there is great purification and ultimately perfection, which is discussed very sweetly and fully in Swami Vivekananda's Karma Yoga, in his discussion of the butcher and his service to his mother and father. His service to them is perfect. His service in his profession, though he is in the lowest of professions, his profession is practiced perfectly. And so he attains perfection and transcendence. So yes, the duties are there. We all have our duties. In what spirit do we do them? Do we do them with a sense of I, me, mine? Or do we do them in a spirit of thou, thee, thine? If we do them with a selfish motive, as Sri Krishna points out, it leads to anxiety and disappointment and attachment to karma. If we do them in a spirit of thou, thee, thine, or as Sri Krishna says, sacramentally, offering everything to the divine, every action, every thought, every perception, then we are free from the karma and free from anxiety. And we live in that state of contentment and ultimately transcendence that is promised by Karma Yoga. We'll talk more about this tomorrow, this Karma Yoga aspect. Karma as it ties to Raja. Anything else from anyone?
So just a quick observation. It looks like we're here studying Raja Yoga, but Cindy and Frank gave us a filter of Bhakti Yoga, and then Amanda and Nina brought the same example, but with a filter of Karma Yoga. So just, you know.
they all integrate. They are not separate. They are all integrated at their heart and core. As we'll talk about tomorrow, there is a real intimate connection between the teachings of chapter 3 of the Gita and chapter 1 of Patanjali's Raja, chapter 1 of Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. Thank you, Bhaskar. Shall we read on? All right. We have already described this discipline in discussing Patanjali's aphorisms on the thought waves. We've described this discipline, what's discipline he's talking about, in discussing Patanjali's aphorisms on the thought waves. For the thought waves are, of course, projections of the guna forces. And this is something for us to keep firmly in mind. The thoughts, the feelings, even the perceptions that arise in us that make up our ongoing daily reality, for the most part, there are moments where we're beyond the gunas. Even in our ordinary state, we have these peak experiences. Rarely, but they're there. But most of what is in our experience is the result of our prior experience of name and form in these mental impressions in the mind. And the gunas touch on these mental impressions And so a thought, a feeling, a perception will arise. And it's nothing more than the guna or gunas in that moment, touching on those old mental impressions or samskaras or vasanas. So that's what's meant here by thought waves are, of course, projections of the guna forces. The gunas give, as Swami Vivekananda says, a blow to these mental impressions, soft blow, hard blow, whatever it is, and something arises as a result. This is our karma. As the Gita puts it, a man is said to have transcended the gunas when he does not hate the light of sattva or the activity of rajas or even the delusion of tamas. In other words, when he does not hate the three robbers. He simply understands what they are. That human being, that person, understands. To read what the Gita says, a man, a human being, is said to have transcended the gunas when that human being does not hate the light of sattva or the activity of rajas, or even the delusion of tamas, while these prevail, and yet does not long for them after they have ceased. So this is that lack of anxiety and genuine contentment beyond the contentment of sattva that exists when we no longer are imprisoned by the activity of the gunas. So doesn't hate them when they're present, doesn't long for them after they've ceased. That person is like one who sits unconcerned and is not disturbed by the gunas. That person knows that they are the doers of all action, that is the gunas. That person knows that the gunas are the doers of all action and never loses this power of discrimination. Is there anything that wants to be said from any of you about what the Swami has just told us?
Brother Shankar?
Yes.
I've read the Gita a few times. I've read the Upanishads and I've read How to Know God. I never remembered hearing that. I guess I wasn't ready to hear it because I'd never remembered hearing that. And now it hit me like a ton of bricks. I remember asking you about a week or two ago, what do we do when we don't like the gunas within us? I don't like very often who I am. I don't like my personality. I don't like how the gunas manifest. And I've been struggling with that. And with what you had just said about transcending how they manifest in me as me. And it doesn't mean I don't work on myself or address them. What I took it to mean is it will not be helpful, it will not assist me to hate them within myself, to not hate myself, to not hate how they're manifesting, to accept them as they are, where they are, meet them where they are, and then grow with them. And that's what I took from that.
Indeed, and when when we can simply gaze at what manifests as the result of the gunas doing what they do, when we can simply be in that witness position and gaze at that and say, well, that's what's happening in this moment, then we have this just little bit of separation between the reaction and our ability to act appropriately, auspiciously in that moment. And oftentimes no reaction is required at all. No action is required. We simply say, oh, well, ordinarily I would have reacted to this, but I don't need to. It will pass away. It will all pass away. The gunas will go on and do something else. There's no reason for me to be attached to what has arisen in this moment. And sometimes it's very unpleasant. You're absolutely right. We just think, how can that be? But then when you regain that witness position, that discrimination, you say, well, that's just the way it is. That's what's there in my storehouse of mental impressions. Doesn't mean that that's who I am. It just means that's what's happened. And so the mental impressions are there. Thank you, Frank. Again, as always, your straightforwardness is so refreshing. Oh, the pollens are getting to my symptom. Anything else from anyone?
I wanted to ask Brother Shankara, when you talk about the separation, that has to happen in the moment with the awareness. Am I right?
Well, that's the only way it can happen, dear. We are in that witness position. We've adopted that witness way of seeing ourselves and the world that we live in. And so it happens moment to moment. We gain it, we lose it, we gain it, we lose it. The more we practice it, the more we remain in possession of that discrimination that comes from sitting in that witness seat. And so we become more and more able to either simply not act at all because there's nothing required of us, or if there is an action, we become more and more perfected in our ability to act auspiciously or appropriately. As Sri Ramakrishna says, you finally become like an expert dancer that cannot put a foot wrong, or an expert musician who cannot hit a wrong note, an expert singer, he says, who cannot hit a wrong note. And it's the reason being that rather than the person dancing to the music or singing the music is flowing through them and producing exactly the appropriate dance step or song note.
So there is no self-judgment also involved in it. You're just simply gazing it, but you're not really judging it.
Well, if we judge ourselves, that in itself is inauspicious.
Yes.
But what's even more inauspicious is that if we judge ourselves, we project that and judge others, which further separates us from them.
Yes.
As is said, judgment is just a way to keep reality at arm's length. So we don't have to gaze at it for what it is. In other words, observe it closely and clearly. but not react either with judgment or any other reaction. There may be an action called for. As Krishna Kali said the other day, well, does that mean we condone? No, we don't condone. There may be an appropriate action required in response to something that has happened. We don't just let it be in that sense.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Okay, the key is the end here. Never loses this power of discrimination. That person knows that the gunas are the doers of all action and never loses this power of discrimination. That person rests in the inner calm of the Atman regarding happiness and suffering as one. This is all a quote from the Gita. Rests in the inner calm of the Atman. This is that witness seat. This is its appearance within us. We experience the Atman first as this witness that is ever calm, ever non-reactive, and completely observant. That person rests in the inner calm of the Atman regarding happiness and suffering as one. What does it mean, one? It just means it's something that arises and passes away. It's one in that it is the action of the gunas. It will come, it will go, and there is no stopping it. No matter how we try, there's no stopping it. We can, by our spiritual practices, particularly the practice of devotion, slowly and slowly reduce the impact of our karmas. So as Holy Mother said, if you were to lose a leg, it isn't that nothing will happen. You no longer need the lesson of losing a leg, but something must happen so you will receive a scratch. This is the outcome of abiding in this inner calm of the Atman. We have seen that the interaction of the gunas provides the motive power for the creative process. When that arises in us, do we stifle it? No. We let that creative process take its course. Now we can consider its stages. In the Hindu system, the first stage of evolution from undifferentiated prakriti is called Mahat, the great cause. So let me go back and make that transition again. We have seen that the interaction of the gunas provides the motive power for the creative process. Now we're going to talk about the creative process in its grandest manifestation, that is, universe itself. Now we can consider its stages. In the Hindu system, the first stage of evolution from undifferentiated prakriti is called Mahat, the great cause. Mahat is the cosmic ego sense the first dawning of differentiated consciousness. Now, we're way far from human beings at this point. And this is why human beings get confused. They think that their awareness of this ego sense means that they are separate. No, it's just a reflection of this cosmic ego sense, this first differentiation of undifferentiated consciousness, the dawning of differentiated consciousness. It may perhaps be compared to the spirit moving on the face of the waters, which is mentioned in the book of Genesis. This is a parallel that the Swami is drawing. Most of us who come from the Christian tradition know this, the spirit moving on the face of the waters. And all is still darkness. There is no manifestation yet. There is just the spirit present. Let's just pause there and see if there's anything anyone wants to contribute. We've still got plenty of time, so there's plenty of time for discussion of this idea of moving from no-thingness, the gunas in perfect equilibrium, to this beginning of manifestation, the great cause or Mahat, when the cosmic ego sense, as he says, dawns. Anything at all about that?
Shankaraji?
Yes.
I think this is where the Swamiji is talking about the differentiated consciousness, the ego. He is talking about from the original consciousness, we get this reflected consciousness, which is the ego.
Well, this is, we're a long way from there yet, though, Balakrishna. Thank you for bringing that in. Yes, we'll get to that reflection in the mind. Later on, but we've just talked about the very first of the cosmic principles, of the 24 cosmic principles, Mahat.
I have a question, Swamiji.
Yes, please.
How do you get from undifferentiated Satchitananda to the gunas at all? What's the step between Brahman and the appearance of the gunas?
It's interesting. Swami Sarva Priyananda was asked this question. Why does it do this? Why does Purusha empower Prakriti to do this? And his answer was very illuminating. He said, well, the answer actually is very American. Because it can. End of sentence, period, end of paragraph. There is no way for us to understand with our limited mind, our finite mind, why the undifferentiated becomes differentiated, and the gunas in perfect equilibrium. We know it does it. We understand from the scriptures that it does it repeatedly, that there are these great cycles, hundreds of a hundred and more billion years long of this period of differentiation and complexification and specialization, which is the definition of anti-entropy. And then there are these periods of perfect entropy, absolute zero. The day of Brahma, the night of Brahma. There is, according to both Sarvapriyananda, and if you go back into the teachings of Swami Vivekananda and Sri Ramakrishna, there is no way of our left mind knowing the answer. But when we achieve this transcendence, this Turiya state, there is a kind of knowing that cannot be spoken in words or concepts. It's what Jesus was speaking of when he said, the peace that passeth all understanding. And so the saints embody it. In the Western tradition, there are many, very prominently Meister Eckhart, who himself had a vision of this Mahat process. He called it a boiling in the ground of being, bolito. Thanks for the question. Sorry that there isn't a more definitive answer, but that's what's known from here.
Oh, that's a beautiful answer. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else from anyone? This is, we should not build on the rest of the 24 cosmic principles until there is clarity about what the Swami means by Mahat.
Brother Shankara, this is Haima.
Yes, Haima.
I just have one question. I recently started reading Torah. Genesis is number one, the first chapter. And here he said, spirit moving on the face of the waters. What does it mean? Can I just have a little description, just a little example, so I can understand Genesis more?
Well, the waters is the metaphor for the undifferentiated. Water not in waves. The spirit moving on the face of the waters begins to cause these waveforms. Everything exists in the form of vibration. The Vashishta tells us this, the Vedas tell us this, Don Lincoln of Fermi Labs, you know, the PhD who studies these things minutely, tells us this. There is nothing but vibration. So somehow the undifferentiated, that which is not in vibration, is caused to vibrate or be in wave form. This is the what happens when the spirit moves on the face of the waters. Imagine wind blowing across a still lake. First little ripples form. Then if the wind persists, particularly if it becomes stronger, the ripples join and become larger. And finally, you get actual waves that break. This is the process that we're going to describe as we go from Mahat to Buddhi to Ahamkara and so on.
Thank you, Brother Shankara. Very nice. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
It's just interesting to me and kind of funny. And I know we can't understand it with the limitations of our minds, but that these things exist, the gunas, in this state of equilibrium. And it's funny that they can exist because they don't really, because they're so different, the three from the other. And if they're in equilibrium and there's no vibration, then they're the same. And they're one or something. I don't know. It's just, it's funny and interesting.
You're absolutely right. what happens is they go into a potential state. They have the potential to become tamas, the potential to become rajas, the potential to become sattva, but they don't exist as that. You're right. It all retreats to no vibration whatsoever, absolute zero in terms of physics. And so, of course, they don't exist. Only, and this is where Stephen Hawking was headed, the great astrophysicist and physicist, quantum physicist. This is where he was heading at the end of his life. He said, in this state of undifferentiation, only the information exists. In other words, the potential for form, name and form. The information exists from which a new manifestation may arise. And he was talking about it being a continuous process, not just a one-time process. Within one of these periods of manifestation, and this is the role of black holes, and he was talking about the emanations from black holes being pure information, and the physicists have named that Hawking radiation. So yes, you're absolutely right. It defies our understanding, but we can marvel at it. And that's about our only choice, really.
And go with it.
Yes, and go with it. Yes. Anything else before we move on to principles 2 and 3, cosmic principles 2 and 3?
Brother Shankara, I have a funny example.
Yes, Krishna Kali.
You know, the heart monitor kind of exemplifies the gunas. When you see a jaggedy peak and ridge and all those jaggedy points, you are alive because all the gunas are in agitation. When you are dead, it's a single line, and that line could be, you know, the potential. So when you are dead, it's a single line, which means there's no agitation and you have gone beyond the gunas. So I kind of take that like an example of the, you know, so basically if your gunas are all over the place, you are alive. And if it is all straight, it is potential.
A very, very apt metaphor. Very nicely figured. Yes. An EKG measures the activity of the gunas as represented by our heart, the four parts of our heart, the two ventricles, the two atria, performing their functions. Thank you, Krishna Kali. Anything else from anyone? Okay. From Mahat is evolved Buddhi, the discriminating faculty, which has already been described. Telling one thing from another is this discriminating faculty. This is a quark. This is a lepton. Okay? That's the discriminating faculty. From buddhi is evolved ahamkar, the individual ego sense, but the one individual, not. It's a reflection in us. As a cosmic principle, it is that individuated divine presence, that cosmic ego sense has manifested as Mahat, the great cause. Now it can tell one thing from another, and now it says, I tell one thing from another. Now, of course, this is reflected in us, but it's only a reflection. none of this exists in the Atman. The undifferentiated Atman. It exists in the Saguna Atman, that which is manifest to our awareness. This is what gets so delicate and confusing. Is there anyone who would like to ask a question or make a comment about this business of the reality and its reflection?
Brother Chakra, this is Fred.
Yes, Fred.
This may be way off base, but would that then be the Ishvara's ego?
Yes, exactly. It's not off base at all. This is Ishvara, Ishwari.
Okay. All right.
That
starts to sound like
that. That is that. And they are then master of the whole rest of the process, as Krishna describes in the Gita. You know, I am master of the gunas. All the rest of this is the doing of Ishvara Ishwari. It has a feminine as well as a masculine aspect. Om. This is the sound of the great cause. This is the sound of Mahat. Om Oing Shring. Now we have Buddhi and Ahamkar in its masculine and feminine, its dualistic form. So yes, very well reasoned, Fred, that this is indeed Ishvara or Ishwari. They are not two beings. They're one being in two forms. They are Om in two forms.
So when we are moving from Buddhi to Ahamkar, is Buddhi non-individuated, and when we go into Ahamkar, you become individuated? Is that the inflection point?
You don't become individuated. The cosmic ego sense, as you say, first develops this ability to tell one thing from another. It is creating and says, oh, this is this and this is that. Then it, so to speak, discovers, oh, I am doing this. So this reflects itself in us, but this is yet a ways down the path before we get to these other cosmic principles that represent themselves as the human being. The 11 cosmic principles that represent themselves as the human being are the mind and the 5 organs of perception and the 5 organs of action. These are what are, they constitute the human being. And they are a creation of the gunas. Very deliberately. I'm going to create a reflection of this so that it can experience itself, because it can. Thank you, Bhaskar.
So, Brother Shankara, so when Mahat starts to get the discrimination power, that's where duality begins, and from duality comes all problems, right? I mean, the egoism and the situation. It's only when you discriminate.
You see, it is not a problem. It is not in any sense a problem for Purusha or Prakriti. It only seems to be a problem for us. And that's because of our attachment to one way of being or another. the cosmic being manifest as Mahat, then Buddhi, then Ahamkar, has no attachment to any particular way of being. They just bring all this into existence, knowing that yes, there will be duality. Now this being knows there will be duality, and that they will experience it. But they're not attached to any particular mode or way of being. So the fact that things change and change and change and change over apparently a period of 110 billion years is simply, that's what is. It's only in us who develop this capacity for attachment and aversion that these things, this endless change, is a problem. As has been brought up in more than one instance, Swami Vivekananda was very fond of chocolate ice cream. At one time at the table at Ridgely, he had finished his meal. He'd gotten up and left the table and was headed out into the library when Mrs. Leggett said, "Oh, Swamiji, we have chocolate ice cream for dessert." He did a 180 on the spot and headed back to his chair. The difference between most of us and Swami Vivekananda, if chocolate ice cream, if the whole idea of ice cream had simply vanished from universe, he would have perhaps had a thought something like, "Oh, that's a shame." And that would have been it. There would have been no attachment, no yearning for further chocolate ice cream, though he liked it very well. This is the difference between ourselves in our state of ignorance and ourselves when we attain this state of transcendence that was talked about earlier. When we are perfectly seated in that witness position, as Saguna Atman, and have no attachment to any or aversion to any particular state of happiness or suffering. Now, I know that seems inconceivable to us. All I can say is, if you have the opportunity, when Swami Sarvadevananda comes, you'll be here May 17th, 18th, 19th. Find an opportunity to have his darshan, to be in his presence. You will experience a being, what is a being? This is the divine having the human experience as Swami Sarvadevananda, but you will find someone who is not attached to any particular way of things going. So I recommend anyone who has the opportunity during those 3 days when the Swami's here, he'll be here from the, I don't know just when he's arriving, but sometime in the early to late afternoon of the 17th, and you'll be here the whole day of the 18th and through the early afternoon of the 19th, and then he flies to Chicago. So any of you who want to know what it means to be in the presence of someone who exemplifies what we're talking about, please take the opportunity to have Swami Sarvadevananda's darshan. Well, it's now 1 o'clock. Are there any final thoughts from anyone before we go on?
Can I say something, Brother Shankara?
Of course you can, dear.
Ramana Maharshi said this thing to a devotee who came to ask him how to, you know, get beyond all of this, and, you know, transcend all of this. And his answer was, go back the way you came from. So he upset and said, he's asking me to go back. I came all the way from this other place and I walked and I took a train and I did that. Then the others explained to him, that's not what he means. Go back the way you came from, meaning go back from egoism to buddhi to mahat is what I'm getting. So this is what he meant. Go back to, you know, this degeneration that we've had. We will not call it degeneration, but the metamorphosis we've had from going from mahat to buddhi to ego, let's go back the other way and go back to non-duality.
But that's very nicely put, yes. But that's exactly what we're doing when we attain that witness position of we're seeing all these things. They arise, they pass away. But something in us knows that we are not the arising, the passing away. We are not the ego sense, the reflected ego sense. We are not the reflected discriminatory sense, the buddhi. We're certainly not the mind or the five organs of action or five organs of perception. We are that which is beyond all those things, which is beyond time, space, and causation, and its creators, the gunas. Nicely said, Krishna Kali.
And like Krishna Kali suggested, we need to stop trying to get there in a car or train or a bus or a plane, because that's what we're doing when we try to use our mind to get there.
Exactly. As Swami Prabhupada said so poignantly, trying to get there with the mind is like trying to empty the ocean of consciousness with a teaspoon. It ain't gonna happen. As Vivekananda told us, we are infinite dreamers dreaming finite dreams. So as long as we're hooked on our finite dreams, we'll never know ourselves as the infinite dreamer. Now, does that mean that we're bad and wrong for being ignorant? Of course it doesn't. It simply says to us, well, if I'm tired of this, if I'm tired enough of this, I'll come on a Saturday at noon and I'll listen to these ideas as expressed by this great soul, Swami Prabhupada, and then I'll do my best to put them into operation in my life. And with any good fortune, I will find some teacher who will give me further instruction. That is the role of the teacher, the remover of darkness, the remover of ignorance. And so then I'll be able to clear the path that much more easily. Some of you know that Swami Yogeshananda was the teacher here, the guru. He had a number of disciples that he initiated, gave these kinds of spiritual instruction. One of them, after Swami Yogeshananda passed away, had left the body shortly afterwards, within the next month, had a dream vision. Swami Prabhavananda called these visitations. And here was Swami Yogeshananda on the grounds of this center. Well, there were a group of people here cleaning up the place, the kind of thing we call a Seva Saturday. And the Swami was supervising. And he encountered this particular disciple, and he said to him, in this very happy and very transparently spiritual sense, he said to him with a gesture, clear the path. So this disciple, who's a dear friend of mine, is taking that very seriously. Each of us can clear the path to find our way back, as Ramana Maharshi said. Krishna Kali related this story. Ramana Maharshi said, go back the way you've come. Well, that means clearing the path of our ignorance and our attachments and our aversions and so on. Anything else from anyone?
I seem to hear the echoes of someone having said, to experience the oneness, simply cease to view the duality.
Yes. Well, that Ramana Maharshi said things like that. Nisargadatta said things like that. And if you read Swami Vivekananda's inspired talks, he emphatically said that. He said, just stop seeing the duality and see the oneness. Over and over, he repeats that in the talks that he gave that are collected as inspired talks. And Swami Turiyananda told that to a disciple on the streets of New York one time, when the disciple was remarking on all the distractions that appeared to us on these city streets. And Turiyananda he shouted at him, well, just stop it. Stop seeing them all. Stop it. Thank you, Amadas. Any final thought from anyone?
The way I look at it is, and I don't know if this is a right view or an unskillful view, is that the entire universe, to me, is being created from moment to moment in my mind, all the way from Nirguna Brahman to 2022, and me sitting right here as a personality body. So,
precisely.
I am that.
Yes, you are that. And you are projecting this moment, yes. And as we go along in Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, we'll find exactly how to still the thought waves of the mind, which is a six-step process. Still the thought waves of the mind. And when the thought waves of the mind are stilled in the mind stuff, that which is sitting there is the person who just spoke to us. When all of those thought waves have been stilled, your projection of universe disappears. Something else takes its place, but there is no knower there. So when you return from that state of being, you are transformed, but you can't tell us what happened or why you're transformed.
And that's Nirvikalpa Samadhi?
That's Nirvikalpa Samadhi, that's right. There is a preliminary step called Savikalpa Samadhi that is also transformative and prepares you for this next step. Savikalpa Samadhi is when you are witness to in this witness position of the Atman, but it's still Saguna Atman. There's still an experiencer, an experience, and an experienced. But nevertheless, everything other than the truth of your being is pushed to the periphery. And all you see is the truth of your being. And you see this individuated part, this individuated human experience as a part of that. But it's still an experience. And so you return from the experience, you're transformed. All of those things that have been pushed to the periphery have now returned, but they too, your experience of them is also transformed. And so you're now, as Patanjali says, these first six steps are something that are done. Purushakara, an action of the individuated being, seemingly. The first six limbs of yoga are something that you do, self-effort. The last two, this great samadhi and the liberation that comes, and the liberation is has a different flavor within Raja Yoga. It's utter independence. No dependence, no conditioning of any kind. He says, those are something that happens to you. So very well observed. You are that. Anything else from anyone? All right. Om Hari Om. Om Asato Ma Sat Gamaya. Tamaso Ma Jyotir Gamaya. Mrityor Ma Amritam Gamaya. Abhir Abhir Moiti. O dearly beloved Lord, lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from this realm of endless noise and relentless confusion to thine abode of silence, serenity, clarity, and peace. Lead us from darkness to light. Lead us from darkness and ignorance to the brilliance of thy wisdom and love. Lead us from darkness and ignorance to the brilliance of thy wisdom and love. Lead us from death to immortality. Light us through and through. Light us through and through with thy everlasting, shining presence. O dearly beloved, a flower at your feet for each one who comes to your open door. A flower at your feet for each one who stands by your open door and says, come to me, come to me. Offering to break this world's chain that binds us down to ignorance, suffering, and death. A flower at your feet for each one who takes the path that you have struck through this, your jungle world. Om Amen. Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Peace, peace, peace be unto us. And to all beloved beings everywhere. May we be safe, may we be healthy, may we be cheerful, may we go forward, may we have peace of mind, may we go forward in the loving and protective embrace of the divine being as our mother and father. Any final thought from anyone? All right, dears. Tomorrow morning, your karma raja cocktail with an unexpected bartender. So that's the invitation to tomorrow morning. And then, of course, next week we'll have our regular classes, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Saturday. Any last thought from anyone? All right. Until tomorrow morning, for those of you who make time to join us.
Pranams, Brother Shankara.
Until then, dears, bye-bye.